My name is Rebecca Sadoun. I'm a resident in the Departments of Internal Medicine and Pediatrics at Duke University, and this is a Learning in 10 on tuberculosis infection. By the end of this presentation, you will be able to describe the organism responsible for TB, explain the significance of latent versus active infections, recognize pulmonary as well as extrapulmonary TB symptoms, describe risk factors for infection in non-endemic areas, describe appropriate droplet precautions, describe the approach to the diagnosis and treatment of TB, recognize the significance of multi-drug resistant TB strains, and appreciate the worldwide disease burden of TB. By way of a quick outline, we'll start by talking about the mycobacterium organism. We'll also discuss transmission of and protection from mycobacterium. We'll talk a little about populations who are at risk for infection, as well as differentiate between latent and active TB infections. Provide a list of symptoms of active TB, and then discuss treatment for TB, differentiating again between latent and active disease. We'll spend some time talking about multi-drug resistant strains of TB, and we'll conclude by talking about the worldwide disease burden of TB. The organism most commonly responsible for tuberculosis infections is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but in HIV-positive patients, this can also be caused by Mycobacterium avium complex, also known as MAC. When looking for the organism, you'll stain with the Zeal-Nielsen staining, and the organism will appear like the red snapper fish. This is also known as acid-fast staining, and so they are acid-fast bacilli, abbreviated as AFB. Transmission of tuberculosis is airborne, which is to say the organism is transmitted in 1 to 5 micron diameter droplet nuclei. In order to stop the spread of these nuclei, airborne precautions are implemented, and this includes both contact precautions, hand washing, and airborne precautions, including an airborne infection isolation room. This is a negative pressure room to keep all the molecules of air in the room, and also includes a HEPA filter. Any healthcare workers or family members who enter the room should wear an N95 mask to protect them from the infection. But you're most likely to interact initially with patients in the waiting room, in their homes, in the clinic, in the emergency department, and not after isolation has been developed. And in these instances, the first step is to ask the patient to wear a surgical mask. So who's at risk for developing TB? Risk for exposure to TB, and this usually leads to latent infection, includes having lived in close quarters, like the military, prison, nursing homes, or homeless shelters, having used injection drugs, having lived in high-prevalence regions such as Southeast Asia or Sub-Saharan Africa, having a family member who was known to have the disease or who died from a bad cough, having worked in the healthcare setting, and that, of course, is all of us. And then risk for active TB disease is any of the above combined with immune system compromise such as HIV or AIDS, chemotherapy, cancer, alcoholism, etc. When thinking about active versus latent disease, individuals with a healthy immune system are able to contain the organism in tubercles. So the patient remains asymptomatic. The organism does not proliferate or spread throughout the lungs, and therefore the patient does not spread it when coughing. And the person's immune system, because it's been exposed to the organism, will make antibodies and will always produce inflammation when re-exposed to the TB antigen. And that's how the PPD test can test for previous exposure in any patient who has a latent disease. In hosts with a compromised immune system, however, the bacilli proliferate, flood the alveoli in the lung, enter the bloodstream, and spread to other organs. Symptoms of active disease are both pulmonary and constitutional. Pulmonary include cough, often with blood-tinged sputum, and often with chest pain, as well as constitutional symptoms that include fever, weight loss, night sweats, and fatigue. Certainly other diseases cause these, but if you're thinking about tuberculosis, you want to ask about all of these. In addition, patients can have extrapulmonary symptoms if they have active disease, and these can include meningitis. It's a subacute or chronic form of meningitis, not the acute bacterial form that develops in a couple of days, but rather one that smolders for weeks to months. Patients can also develop scrofula, as depicted in the image on the top, And this is infection of the lymph nodes, usually of the neck, with granulomas. Patients can also develop Pott's disease, depicted in the lower image, and this is infection and granulomatous invasion of the spinal bones. And then there's miliary TB, which is disseminated TB throughout the lungs and throughout the body. Testing for latent TB is usually performed with the MAN2 test. This is also known as the PPD, or tuberculin sensitivity test. And the test is performed by injecting 5 units of purified protein, or 0.1 cc's, intradermally. And then the patient is brought back 48 to 72 hours later to have their arm read. And you read the test by looking at the arm and looking at or feeling for the area that's indurated, and that is to say the area that is raised, and measuring the diameter of the raised area. It's important to note this is not the diameter of the erythematous, or the red area, but rather the area that is raised. A positive test for TB is defined as 5 millimeters in diameter if the patient is HIV positive or a known recent contact with an active TB case, or a patient who is severely immunosuppressed and therefore not likely to mount a significant inflammatory reaction, such as a patient who had an organ transplant and is now on chronic steroids. If the patient is an immigrant in the past 5 years from a high-prevalence country, currently lives in a high-prevalence country, is an injection drug user, a resident or employee of a hospital, a prison, a nursing home, homeless shelter, or in the military, or if they have moderate immunosuppression, which would include diabetes, cancers, end-stage renal disease, low-dose steroids, or children under the age of 4. And then 10 millimeters of diameter is used as the threshold for diagnosing latent TB. And for a patient who has no known risk factors for TB, 15 millimeters of diameter is used as the diagnosis. And this here is a depiction of somebody who is actually measuring the area of induration. That's that raised area in the center. Again, they ignore the area of erythema surrounding it. There's also a blood test known as QuantiFERON TB Gold. This takes a blood sample and measures for exposure TB and is turned around in about 24 hours. It's important to note that both for the MAN2 test and for the QuantiFERON TB Gold test, they are measuring exposure to the protein or the antigens in TB. And this would be exposure either to the organism or exposure to the BCG vaccine for TB. In the United States, this vaccine is not used, but in multiple countries with a high prevalence, it is. It is impossible with either of these two tests to differentiate between patients who have previously had the vaccine and patients who have been exposed to TB and developed latent infections themselves. If testing a patient for active TB, you'll first obtain a chest x-ray. Any cavitary lesion as depicted in this image, or a nodule with a poorly defined margin, or hilar or mediastinal lymphadenopathy would be indication of active TB, as would miliary lung disease, and this is an image in which it looks like there are many seeds strewn throughout the lungs. You would also want to obtain sputum cultures, and this would be 3 sets of sputum cultures, which you would test for acid-fast bacilli. If any of these return positive, the patient would be treated for 6 months for active TB, and then you'd repeat the test, all 3 sputum cultures again. The patient would only be cleared of the infection when 3 in a row come back negative. When untreated, TB is fatal in approximately 50% of cases. Treatment of active TB entails a minimum of 6 months of medications. The mnemonic 4-for-2 and 2-for-4 is helpful to remember that for the first 2 months, 4 antibiotics are used. These are isoniazid, ethambutol, rifampin, and pyrazinamide. And after the completion of those 2 months, an additional 4 months of treatment includes the following 2 antibiotics, isoniazid and rifampin. If a patient completes all 6 months of medications with good compliance, then the relapse rate is extremely low and only around 2-3%. Treatment of latent TB, however, is attempting to treat an infection that is contained in tubercles and not actively proliferating and therefore requires longer treatment, 9 months, although it only requires 1 antibiotic, and that's isoniazid. Multidrug-resistant TB, also known as MDR-TB, is resistant to both INH and rifampin, so this will require 18 or more months of medications and should always be managed by an infectious disease specialist. Worldwide, an estimated 2 billion people are infected with tuberculosis, and of these, 14 million people have active TB with symptoms. Approximately 1.5 million deaths occur each year from TB, and roughly a third of these are co-infected with HIV. In looking at the graph on the left, this depicts the prevalence of HIV in different countries. The prevalence is highest in the bright yellow areas, including sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia. And looking at the graph to the right, this is the reported cases per year to the World Health Organization, which demonstrates that the incidence of new cases each year is still on the rise. In summary, untreated active tuberculosis has a 50% mortality rate. Effective treatment strategies require treating individuals while they have latent TB, and worldwide, we're talking about one-third of the world's population. Treatment of active TB requires 4 drugs for 2 months, followed by 2 drugs for 4 months, whereas treatment of latent TB requires INH for 9 months. Partial adherence to medication regimens is what produces multidrug-resistant TB strains, and this has a dramatically increased mortality rate. And you can protect yourself from exposure by using an N95 mask when having known contact with a patient, or by asking the patient to wear a surgical mask if you're even considering the possibility of their having TB. We say mask first and questions later.